Hey everybody, welcome. Welcome back. And summer is officially upon us and it's nice and hot and sweaty. And I hope you guys are enjoying it. And yeah. So today we're going through John, 1 John 2 verses 7 to 11. And we're just going to read from that. And it says, "Brethren, I write no new commandment to you, but an old commandment which you have had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which you heard from the beginning. Again, a new commandment I write to you, which thing is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. He who says he is in the light and hates his brother is in darkness until now. He who loves his brother and abides in the light, and there is no cause for stumbling in him. But he who hates his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and does not know where he is going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes." Wow. Bit confusing. New commandment, old commandment. No, it's an old one. No, but I give you a new one. But we'll explain it now. So let's open in prayer. Father, we thank you that your word is true, that your word is always true, Father. And we thank you, Lord, that today you will be with us, that you will lead us and guide us and help us just to convey this message, this word that you want us to convey, Father. Pray that your Holy Spirit will prepare everybody that hears it. Father, we pray that your Holy Spirit will lead and guide me, use me as a vessel to convey the word that you want conveyed, Father. We thank you that you prepare the hearts of those listening, and that the word, the seed of your faith will fall in fertile soils in the hearts of those that hear it, Father. We also pray for the country today, Father. We pray for the leadership, that they will lead and guide us back into economic stability. But Father, we can also say that we trust in you, as you've placed those leaders in power and you've placed them in position, Father. And we thank you, Lord, that you will lead us and guide us through this in Jesus' glorious name. Amen. Cool. So we'll come back after the song and we'll get into the teaching.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. Oh, I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. You unravel me with a melody, and you surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, until all my fears are gone. And I'm no child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear.
Amazing, guys. Thank you all.
Hey, everybody. So here we go. We continue the adventure in 1 John, the Epistle of John. Okay. And we're going to read from 1 John 2, verses 7 to 11, as we did earlier. But I'm going to cover verse 7 now. So turn with me in your Bibles to verse 7. Brethren, I write no new commandment to you, but an old commandment which you have had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which you heard from the beginning. So, I mean, it gets more confusing when you start off and it says in verse 8, again, a new commandment I write you. It's okay. So it's an old commandment. No, it's a new commandment. But essentially what they're saying is that this commandment has been around for a long time. We can go all the way back to Exodus, okay, where it says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and strength. You shall have no images of God before you, etc., etc., and love your neighbor as yourself. Okay, so it's not a new commandment, but it is kind of a new commandment, because when Jesus came, he put a whole new level onto this whole commandment here. Okay, so if we go back into John 1, John 1, okay, we look at John is talking about obedience. Okay, and walking in obedience to God. And it's easy to say, I know God, but you're not obedient to him. It's easy to say that I do the things that God wants me to do. In other words, I tithe and I give and I serve and I do all these wonderful things that everybody wants me to do as a Christian. Okay, but he's saying that's just obedience. You know, I mean, if following the letter of the law was easy, then the whole of Israel would have been saved today, right? But they're not, okay? Because it's not that easy. So God is saying following laws is one thing, but following love is another, okay? Loving God and loving your neighbor, those are different. That's a whole different level, okay? And so John is saying that he's going to give us a whole commandment here that shows us and ensures that we are walking in obedience. It's not a new commandment. It's an old one, but it's also a new one. And it's but that's not confusing. Okay. So let's go to Matthew 22, 35 to 39. Okay. So if we go back to Matthew 22, 35 to 39, and I'm reading here from the New King James, right? And it says, then one of them, a lawyer, and I remember that Jesus is sitting in the synagogue and he's busy teaching there. And he's sitting there and he says, one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question, testing him. Now, listen to the words here. The lawyer, okay, or learned one, asks a question, testing, okay? So he's not asking to learn, okay? Often people ask a question, not wanting to learn something, wanting to hear what it is that they want to hear. They want the answer that they want. They don't want to learn something, okay? And there's a good saying that goes around, says people often listen not to hear what the person is saying, but to hear the answer that they're looking for. So when you go through the Bible, don't try and find an answer. Don't try and find something that justifies your standpoint or your point of view. Try and listen and hear what Jesus or what God or what one of the apostles is trying to teach us. Okay. So it says the teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? And Jesus says to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. Okay. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Okay, now let's go to Luke. There we go. Luke 10, verse 25 to 29. Now it's exactly the same story, all right? Now we know that if the Bible repeats something more than once, that, you know, logically, because once is not repeated. So if the Bible repeats something, okay, then it is important and we need to listen. Now, if we go to Luke 10, verse 25 to 29, the same story comes up, but Luke has got a different ending to this whole thing. Okay. So he says, and behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him. Again, it's confirming. So it's a learned person who is testing God. He's trying to, or testing Jesus. He's trying to catch him. He's not asking him a question in order to learn something. Okay, saying, teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Now, I want you to hear those words. It's, what shall I do? Everything is about him. His motivation is selfish. It's about him. It's about self. What shall I do to inherit eternal life? And he said to him, what is written in the law? What is your reading of it? Now, in this story, okay, it could have been a different teacher, all right, because they are quite different. In the last one, Jesus gave him the answer. In this one, Jesus is turning it on him, saying to him, what is your reading of it? And the lawyer is a clever man because he gives the right answer. He says, so he answered and said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And then Jesus says to him, you have answered rightly. Do this and you will live. Okay, remember in the first one, he says, what is the greatest commandment? And this lawyer is asking him, what must I do selfishly? What must I do to inherit eternal life? Okay, and he said to him, you have answered rightly. Do this and you will live. Now, this answer wasn't good enough for the lawyer. So what's the next thing he asks him? He says, but he, wanting to justify, listen to the words, wanting to justify himself, said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Okay, so this is one thing that we learn throughout the Old Testament, is that the Israelis, or the nation of Israel, was very good at obeying these laws, but very good at splitting hairs to make the laws suit themselves. Okay, so they would, that's why eventually Israel developed what they call these ring fence laws around. So Jesus, or God, originally gave Israel like 635 or 625 laws, and Israel then went and developed all these ring fence laws. So it's like a fence around a fence around a fence, so that Israel wouldn't get to these original 600 laws, but they kept breaking them. So the laws weren't the things that were helping Israel at all. All right, so these laws are just not working out for, and Israel was very good at splitting hairs about these laws. Okay, so now they're trying to justify that they're going to hate their neighbor, you know, and Jesus doesn't want that. You know, I mean, remember that Jesus took the laws and he elevated them to a whole new level. Remember when they came, he said, you know, the law says that you should not commit adultery, but if I tell you that if you're looking at somebody in lust, then you've already committed adultery. Okay. Another one is where I think it's, where is it now? Sorry. It's where Jesus says, if you hate your neighbor, then you've already committed murder. I mean, that just, you know, that elevates the whole thing. And it's important that we don't harbor this hatred in our hearts for anybody, okay? It's important that we love our neighbor, truly love her, and walk in obedience. This is how we know that we are going to have eternal life, is because we walk in obedience and we do the things that Jesus commanded us to do. And it's hard to think about the whole Bible is summed up. Essentially, all the laws in the Bible are summed up essentially in these two commandments. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and everything else within you, and love your neighbor as yourself. And it's not that easy. Okay, so let's carry on. It says in verse 8, again, a new commandment I write you, which thing is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. He who says he is in the light and hates his brother is in darkness until now. Man, that's crazy. You know, and one thing I find here very interesting was that he who says, let me read it again, he who says he is in the light and hates his brother is in darkness until now. Yeah, who's your brother? I mean, it's your neighbor, it's your friends at school. You know, one of the big things that we need to talk about here, and that's important, is that quite often I know so many people that don't come to church because they had a bad experience at church, because they went into a church where it is perceived that everybody is loving and kind and helpful and gracious and everything. And they went into these churches seeking love and attention and healing and whatever the case may be. And what happens? They got hurt. Somebody went and said something nasty to them. Or quite often you get people that will be in a church for a long time and there will be this inner conflict. There's this war that's going on in the church. And just because you claim to be a Christian doesn't always mean that you are a Christian. Okay, it's again, we can go through this whole thing. Walk in obedience. This is how you know that you are saved. Okay, but so many people don't walk in obedience. I know I slip up sometimes. I mean, this is difficult. This ain't easy. You know, to try and have a measure that is Jesus is so hard. Why? Because he's perfect. He's perfect. And there's just no way on earth that you and I are ever going to be perfect. I mean, it's impossible. It's an impossible measure. It really is. But what's the important thing? That we try. You know, and if you hurt somebody, it's so easy to go back and say, hey, I'm sorry. Actually, it's not. Sometimes it's difficult. Okay, but it's the right thing to do. I've done it before. You know, I've said something nasty and I've thought about it and I've gone, man, that was ugly. That really was ugly. And then I go back and I say, you know what? I said that and I'm so sorry. That was so ugly, so unnecessary. Please forgive me. You know, and that mends a relationship. We have to be so careful as Christians to do the right thing, not to hurt, not to offend. It's not easy, guys. And, you know, unfortunately, there's a lot of people who follow the letter of the law. I mean, you get these, some Christians, man, they go like, but the Bible says, you know? Yeah, but what the Bible's telling you and what you're actually doing, they're very different things, right? Okay, yeah. So, yeah, but the Bible says, yes, I know what the Bible says. I've been studying it for, you know, intimately for like 9 years now. What does the Bible say? I understand what the Bible's saying, but what the Bible tells me to do and what I actually do are very different, you know? And we need to learn to be different. We need to learn to do what the Lord tells us to do. From here, I want you guys to turn to John 13. Sorry, I mean, I'm making you work today, so sorry about that. John 13, verse 34. Okay, and I'm going to read this. Now, Jesus always takes things up to the next level. Remember this, okay? 13, verse 34, it reads, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another." I mean, isn't that just crazy? I mean, Jesus always takes things up a new level. And when we think of how Jesus loved us, he loved us sacrificially. He gave himself for us that we may be free. That sort of love is incredible, okay? It would be equivalent to your friend has a kidney disease and they find out that your tissue type is exactly the same as his and you go and you say, I will give you one of my kidneys so that you can live, okay? That is the kind of sacrifice, but on a whole new level, way higher. Jesus gave his life for us, okay? Now, what we realize as well is that nothing worth doing, let me think how to say this, okay? Everything we do needs to be done sacrificially. We need to suffer, kind of. We need to, and it's not suffering really, but we see it as suffering because we want to have things our own way. We want to do things our own way. We want to be comfortable. You know, everybody goes on Best Life Now. You know, I mean, one of our favorite teachers, your best life now. It's not about that. Your best life is yet to come. Your best life is in future. Your best life is in heaven, right? So everything we do on earth here needs to be kind of a sacrifice. It needs to hurt slightly, okay? Or a lot, okay? It needs to hurt because when we start giving up the things of the world so that we can please God, it hurts. It hurts because the world is constantly telling us that we need to wear this new type of perfume or this new shirt or this new outfit or whatever the case may be. And then everything's going to be cool. Everything's going to be happy. You know, I can tell you something going through life that there were these standards that the world has. You know, if you get a house and two cars, a television, a microwave, and two children, and two dogs and two cats, you are going to be happy. And that's not true. It's not true because true happiness doesn't come from stuff. It comes from within. It comes from contentment and knowing that you are safe and secure in the arms of the Lord. That's where true happiness comes from. Now, back in the Old Testament, in 2 Samuel 24, I'm making you jump around again, verses 18 to 24. So the story here is there's a plague in the land, okay? And Gad, a prophet, comes to, or a priest, comes to David, King David, and says to him that you need to build an altar to the Lord and make sacrifice for this whole thing to come right. So David goes to the threshing floor, and Gad is very specific. It must be the threshing floor of Arunah, I hope I got that right, the Jebusite. Okay, so we read from 18 to 24. And Gad came that day to David and said to him, go up, erect an altar to the Lord on the threshing floor of Arunah the Jebusite. So David, according to the word of God, went up as the Lord commanded. So what's happening? David is being obedient. Let's carry on. Now Arunah looked and saw the king and his servants coming toward him. So Arunah went out and bowed down before the king with his face to the ground. Now I'm sure he was pretty surprised to hear that the king of Israel was walking up to his spot, you see. Imagine you there and like Cyril Ramaphosa comes, rocks up at your door, just unannounced. Hello, with his whole entourage, you know. You're going to be like, what's going on here? Okay, so Arunah felt the same thing. Then Arunah said, why, my lord, the king, why has the Lord, my king, come to his servant? And David said, to buy the threshing floor from you, to build an altar to the Lord, that the plague may be withdrawn from the people. Now Arunah said to David, let my lord, the king, take and offer up here in our oxen for burnt sacrifice and the threshing implements and the yokes and the oxen for wood. Okay. So, of course, Arunah is now going, well, yeah, there's a huge plague in the land. Okay. The things are bad. All right. So, you know, just take it. Take it. All right. There's the oxen. There's the yokes. You know, they're all made out of wood in those days. Take everything and use the yokes as firewood. Sacrifice the oxen because we want to get things right. Okay. So then David says, all these things, O King Arunah, Arunah says, all these things, O King Arunah, has given to the king. All these things, O King Arunah, has given to the king. And Arunah said to the king, may the Lord your God accept you. Then the king said to Arunah, no, but I will surely buy it from you for a price, nor will I offer burnt offerings to the Lord my God with that which costs me nothing. Listen to that. So David bought the threshing floor and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. Okay. Now I'm sure that 50 shekels in those days must have been a lot of money. It's probably worth a lot more than what the threshing floor and what the oxen were. But David said to him, nothing worth doing for my God is worth doing for free. I would rather pay. Okay. So that's why I'm saying, if you're going to do something worthwhile doing, you got to make the sacrifice, guys. Okay, we can't just cruise through life going, well, everything's cool and whatever, you know. We need to make that sacrifice. And this is how we know that we walk in obedience, okay. And you need to remember, guys, you know, we need to be an example to everybody else. We can't be those hypocritical Christians that sit in church like pompous people and You know, I'm sorry. I mean, it's this is important, you know, that we need to be different. We need to be what Jesus called us to be. And when he says, love your neighbor as yourself and love the Lord your God above all, we need to obey those commandments. Okay, let's carry on. So in verse 9, and says, he who says he is in the light and hates his brother is in darkness until now. That means that you can say I'm a Christian, but you hate your brothers and you're not living the Christian life. That means you're not. You can say, things are easy to say, okay? But being, really being that thing is different, okay? And then in verse 10, it says, he who loves his brother abides in the light. In the light could be seen in two ways. You're walking in the daylight, but the light is also the love of Jesus Christ, okay? Abides in the light. And there is no cause for stumbling in him, okay? So, but then in verse 11, it says, but he who hates his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and does not know where he is going because the darkness has blinded his eyes. Now, what I find very interesting here, guys, is that it says because the darkness has blinded his eyes. But if you think about it, if you're walking in dark, your eyes adjust eventually and you can actually see something, correct? Okay. So the darkness has blinded your eyes, but you can still see what you're doing. You're committing sin and you know that you're doing it because the darkness has blinded you. The darkness is another reference to Satan and evil and sin. Could be seen as darkness. The light is seen as Jesus. Okay. But what's also interesting, imagine normally we as humans, we twist things around. So normally we as humans would say, you know, if you're walking in darkness and suddenly somebody flashes a bright light into your eyes, then you'd be blinded. Am I right? I mean, if you're walking during the day and you look up at the sun briefly, I mean, you look down, you're just going to see blackness. So it's actually light that, but Jesus put it differently here. He's saying that you are, the blindness is, John is putting it differently, sorry. He's saying that the darkness has blinded you. Okay, you can still see, but you live in your sin. I mean, the light is what normally would blind you completely if you think about it in that term. Okay, so guys, I hope you got something out of this. So how do we know that we are walking in obedience? Is because we don't hate our neighbor. So when you got that friend at school that's offended you, go and make right with him. Because if you don't, you're walking in darkness. All right, and be loving and kind and supportive to one another, building each other up, encouraging one another, and really driving forward that message of love and that message of strengthening and supporting one another. So you guys have a good week, and I will see you next week. Cool. Peace out. Ciao.